our citizens, for our consumers.
Manila lifts its face shield mandate, with the rest of the capital region expected to follow suit. The White House expressing confidence its vaccine mandate on American businesses will be upheld. Back here at home, there's a proposal to hold subsidies of indigents if they're not vaccinated. We'll get the reaction of Silvestre Bello, the third secretary of the Labor Department. More children seen out with their families on the first weekend of looser restrictions in Metro Manila. Are we letting our guard down too soon? Dr. Maricar Limpin, president of the Philippine College of Physicians, joins us later on in the program. And motorists finally get some relief after 10 weeks of oil price hikes. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us, and for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. We begin with this story. Manila residents can now breathe and see easier as the capital city lifts its face shield mandate. Manila Mayor Francisco Isko Moreno Domagoso signed an executive order making the wearing of face shields non-mandatory except in hospitals or medical settings. Moreno had been pushing to stop the mandatory use of face shields since last year, saying there is no scientific basis that proves it could curb the spread of COVID-19. And the rest of the capital region will or could soon follow suit. Metro Manila Development Authority Chairman Benhur Abalo says the region's mayors have also agreed to do away with the face shield requirement.
Wala na hong face shield maliban lamang sa mga critical areas, kamukha ng hospital, kamukha ng health centers, all other places except those listed as critical ng DICG, wala na hong shield. Yan ang official position ng Metro Manila na aming dadalhin po sa IATF.
Davao City was the first to drop its face shield mandate last week in an executive order. The local government said the wearing of face shields will now be voluntary and is only recommended in crowded areas as well as confined spaces. Most members of the interagency task force also want to make the use of face shields voluntary. That's according to the IATF's chief implementer, Carlito Galvez Jr. He says IATF officials have recommended limiting the use of face shields in hospitals and other high-risk areas.
Hopefully within this week or as soon as possible, magkaroon po tayo ng tinatawag na resolution para gawin ng voluntary ang face shield po.
Vaccine mandates back in the conversation. See, an official of the Interior Department had raised the prospect on Saturday of the possibility of excluding beneficiaries in government's conditional cash transfer program unless they were vaccinated against COVID-19. The Health Department also reportedly in support of such a move if the Philippines is to achieve herd immunity. And based on the latest data from the National Vaccination Operations Center, less than 24% of the A5 category or the indigent population have been fully vaccinated. Opposition senators speaking out against that proposal, Senator Rizo Ontivero suggests the Social Welfare Department should instead come up with more strategies to encourage public acceptance of the vaccines. Senate Minority Leader Franklin Drilon, meanwhile, says the move is illegal, noting there is no prevailing law allowing the Interior Department to only distribute aid to vaccinated individuals. Over in the U.S., the White House is confident a mandate requiring workers to be vaccinated or tested weekly for COVID-19 will be upheld in courts. The Biden administration issued the new vaccine rule last week, which applies to companies with at least 100 employees. It is set to take effect on January 4th, but a U.S. Federal Court of Appeals temporarily blocked that measure, arguing it raises grave legal issues.
Look, these vaccine requirements have been litigated up and down the courts all over the country. State requirements, for example, one in Maine. And every single court before this one ruled that they were valid. The Supreme Court has turned back several times already various efforts to enjoin other vaccine requirements. I'm quite confident that when this finally gets fully adjudicated, not just a temporary order,
right,
the validity of this requirement will be upheld. It's coming.
And more news now. Schools that will participate in the pilot run of limited in-person learning now ready for the November 15 opening. The Philippine Education Department says participating teachers and school personnel have already undergone training. That's to ensure basic health protocols will be strictly implemented during the pilot test. Around 100 public schools are set to participate. DepEd reiterates students are not required to take part in the limited face-to-face classes.
For the learners who will voluntarily attend the in-school classes, vaccination is not a requirement. But for the teachers who will handle the classes, it's a requirement, including all the personnel that will be in the school. We just want to emphasize that still this is something that we need their consent with. So this is voluntary, so we will not force them to make their children attend because we still continue with our distance learning.
Vaccine certificates issued by the country's online portal VaxCertPH now recognized in some countries abroad, but travelers are advised to check if their destination country is part of the current list. Government says it is already talking to more countries to accept the certificate. The government also continues to release yellow cards or international certificates of vaccination for Filipinos traveling abroad. The Bureau of Quarantine cautioning the public against those offering fake cards.
Yun din po ang panawagan namin na marami po kasi ngayon lumalabas na mga nag-o-offer na gustong na pwede daw silang magbigay ng slot sa BOQ. So wala po silang kakayanan na gawin yon at hindi po kami connected in any way. So sana po doon lang po tayo sa icv.boq.ph po pumunta.
For 18 months, the U.S. is set to lift its pandemic travel ban on international tourists. Beginning November 8th, fully vaccinated visitors from 30 countries will be allowed to enter the U.S. They must, however, present proof of vaccination and a recent negative COVID-19 test. The new rule comes as a win for airline companies and travel agencies. Paris-based agency Jet Set Voyages says reservations to the U.S. rebounded from near non-existent to the pre-COVID levels last seen in October of 2019. At least one former health secretary is backing the 2022 presidential bid of Vice President Lenny Robredo. Dr. Manuel Dayrit, who headed the Philippine Health Department during the SARS outbreak in 2002, cited Robredo's brand of leadership and attention to detail as key to getting the country out of the COVID pandemic. Dayrit has been helping the office of the vice president with its COVID initiatives since last year, but he officially announced his endorsement this morning as Robredo further fleshed out her health agenda to the media.
Ang situation ngayon is that madami sa mga tao sa taas. Hindi nila naintindihan yung detalye. Importante yun. Lalo na kung Secretary ko of Health, kailangan naintindihan mo yung detalye. Kailangan alam mo paano kumikilos yung mga tao mo. Tapos kailangan nakaka-work across ka sa mga ibang mga sectors. So talagang mabigat yung trabaho ng isang leader sa gobyerno. So for me, nag-umpisa yan sa pinakamataas. I think si VP Robredo, you know, has the qualities for leadership in pushing the agenda forward. I will support VP Lenny.
Former Health Chief Dr. Esperanza Cabral was also present in Robredo's briefing earlier today, but she says she's willing to lend her expertise to other candidates working to build a pandemic response plan.
There are only
happy to join VP Robredo in crafting a good health agenda. But we are also open to other people who want a good health agenda and may need our help. So we are not exclusive to VP.
The Commission on Elections is set to begin the process of hearing the disqualification case filed against presidential candidate Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. The COMELEC spokesperson, James Jimenez, says the case will be raffled off to one of two divisions of the poll body this week. Summons will also be sent down in the coming days for both sides in relation to the petition against Marcos, which centers on his previous tax conviction. The Marcos camp has brushed off the petition, describing it as a mere nuisance.
So, meron at meron susubok niyan. So, hindi pwedeng sabihin na just because ganyan yung nangyari dati, eh sure na na ganyan ang mangyayari ngayon. Hindi po ganun. Appealable to the Supreme Court.
The One Cebu Party yet to decide who to endorse for president in the 2022 elections. The head of the party, Cebu Governor Gwen Garcia, says they will choose their bet after the deadline of the substitution of candidates lapses on November 15th. She also clarifies that her dinner with presidential aspirant Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. and Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio some weeks ago does not mean she is supporting their possible tandem.
I'm not saying that we are not supporting. We have just not come up with a decision yet. There are others who would say I may be naturally sympathetic to former Senator Bongbong Marcos because of the bonds that have already been established. However, my decision does not necessarily reflect the entire party's decision. We need to come together and reach a consensus so that the entire party, One Cebu, will be fully behind the chosen one.
Apart from Marcos, other presidential candidates who met with Garcia in Cebu include Manila Mayor Isko Moreno and Senator Panfilo Lacson. The supporters of 2022 presidential aspirants continue to hold caravans in various parts of the country. In Ilocos Sur, thousands attended Sunday's motorcade backing the candidacy of Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. Long lines of red supporters filled some streets in the province, as seen in online videos. Vice President Lenny Robredo supporters also paraded through Bataan, with participants adorning their vehicles with pink ribbons. Meanwhile, the supporters of PDP Laban's presidential bet, Senator Ronald Bato de la Rosa, and his vice presidential running mate, Senator Bongo, held a two-day caravan in Metro Manila and in other parts of the country. Sorsogon Governor and senatorial aspirant Francis Escudero insists there is nothing wrong with being a guest candidate of different parties. Escudero is currently part of the senatorial tickets of several presidential bets, namely Vice President Lenny Robredo and Senators Panfilo Lacson and Manny Pacquiao. Escudero says he's even willing to be part of Bongbong Marcos's Senate slate.
I've worked with Senator Marcos. I've worked with people who I don't agree with 100% of the time on all issues. But that does not necessarily make it unlivable for me to be with them or to work with them as well on other issues that we agree on. Sino ba naman ako para magsabi? Let's say a BBM supporter would say, I'm voting for you. Sasabihin, no. Hindi, ayoko yung sinusuporta mong presidente. You would say thank you. And it's not for you to say no to anyone who offers help. But to my mind, Karen, it does not necessarily mean that I have to change any position I will be making. Now, if that is a condition precedent before an adoption would be made, then that's a totally different story.
Escudero, however, says he has yet to decide who to endorse for president and may not necessarily go with a decision of his own party, the Nationalist People's Coalition.
I will wait until after the NPC decides, Karen, being a member of the NPC. Now, if they allow us to decide on our own, then we get to decide on our own. If they don't, if they choose someone which I am not personally comfortable with, then perhaps that's the decision of a party member to still remain with the party and not follow.
Well, families head out with their children on the first weekend of the alert level 2 in Metro Manila. Children were finally allowed to visit malls, parks, churches, and other public areas for the first time since the onset of this pandemic. And this is big. It's a huge relief for travel and tourism and trade departments as they've been pushing for the lifting of the age requirements for tourist areas and establishments.
Ngayon talagang marami nga nakikiusap nga na dapat sana kasama nila yung mga anak nila. So ngayon, all ages na can enjoy Intramuros. No age restrictions when it comes to tourist destinations.
Under Alert Level 2, ay ina-allow na yung minors. Sila ay pwede at since maraming minors hindi pa naman vaccinated talaga, kaya allowed sila na makapasok at pati indoor. Yung dating requirement natin, pag indoor vaccinated, generally speaking, no, except sa minors. At pag outdoor, open to all, vaccinated or unvaccinated.
Meanwhile, a pediatric infectious diseases expert has this reminder for parents heading out with their children.
Now, in our country, we know that a significant proportion of people are still unvaccinated, and that's the role of the parents to manage, no? You think about the consideration that 6 out of every 10 people you're meeting outside, or rather, are vaccinated, but you have 4 people who are not, no? Mm-hmm. So who will be your sources of infection? Definitely the 4 who are not vaccinated, and to a certain degree, the 6 others who are vaccinated. So if you had to defend yourselves against that many people, what would you be doing? I'm sure you'd be quite concerned about making sure about air quality, physical distancing, putting on your mask and shield. So I guess that's the same thing that parents should be aware of when they're bringing their kids out.
Even as the Philippines is now seeing a light at the end of the tunnel, it may be worth to take heed of the example from Europe, which is back at the epicenter of the pandemic. As the Delta variant spreads and vaccination efforts stall, now, can the country sustain its gains while avoiding another surge? Joining us now to discuss this is Dr. Maricarmen Limpin. She is, of course, the president of the Philippine College of Physicians. Dr. Limpin, nice to see you again. Thanks for joining us today.
Yes, thank you, Carmina, for having me here. Good morning to everyone.
All right. So I just want to start off with your assessment, your description of the current COVID situation in the country as we speak.
Well, overall, no, we can see that the number of daily cases in the country has really gone down. And probably because of that, that's the reason why the alert level system in the country has also been relaxed from alert level 4 to 3. And then now we are at alert level 2. No, so we just want to remind everyone that although that we are seeing less number of COVID cases than what we have seen in the previous past weeks, no, the virus is still with us. And therefore, it is really up to us to make sure that we will be protected from, you know, getting infected with the virus. And therefore, there is a really a need to still observe and adhere to the minimum health standards that we often would like to remind them of.
And unless we address the issue of vaccine inequity, we can't really be comfortable with the situation. Doctor, what do you say about that?
Yes, although in the National Capital Region, we know that the vaccination rate has really, you know, stepped up so fast, no? So we have now achieved about 85% at the very least of the population vaccinated. I think that is the adult population, you know, that is not counting the minors. But we have just started vaccinating the minors. Therefore, we have to realize that a big number of our population are really quite young, no? And therefore, many of the people who have actually gone out, no, particularly this last weekend, are really also probably minors and maybe tama si Doctora when she said that out of the 10 people out there, then we have to bear in mind that there are about 4 probably of the 10 would probably be not vaccinated, and therefore they are at higher risk of getting infected, no? Particularly if they go to areas where it is crowded and it's not, and the minimum health standards is actually being compromised.
But here's the problem, Dr. Lim Bin. You said a while ago that majority of our population are young. Majority of our population are also poor. And with this new proposal of withholding the subsidies of four-piece beneficiaries if they don't have any vaccination at all, how do you think that's going to help the problem that we have?
I just hope that, you know, that we're not also... I don't know how serious the LGUs are, no, in terms of really implementing that kind of policy. But I've seen actually some LGUs who did that in the past, no, like let us say for the senior citizens, the monthly stipend that the seniors will receive will actually be put on hold. On hold lang naman, no, not necessary. The local chief executive did not really say that they are not going to give it to the senior citizens, but at least put it on hold. And that would actually, that prompted the other senior citizens who are quite hesitant, no, in having themselves vaccinated to really get the vaccine. And so that actually served as an incentive, no, for people to get vaccinated. So if they will just use it as a means of, you know, incentivizing people to get themselves vaccinated, that's all right. But at the end of the day, it's like, you know, maybe they will need to really give the people their benefits, the benefits that are due them, because these are benefits that they have promised and probably mandated by whatever policy that they have. No? So it's the policy that they already made, and I don't think that they should be holding these benefits that people deserve to get.
Yeah, because actually some lawmakers have already said that it's illegal because it's not a condition for them to get vaccinated to receive their subsidies. But first of all, let me just backtrack a bit. Dr. Lim Bin, you said that you know of some LGUs that have already done this with their senior citizens. May I ask you which LGUs these are?
Ang alam ko, no, from what I know, I think Pasig City has already done this. So that's Mayor Vico Soto. And I know of many senior citizens who actually had themselves vaccinated kasi nga meron silang fear na apaka hindi ko nga matanggap yung aking senior citizen benefit, no? So they got themselves vaccinated. And now, you know, that's those same senior citizens are actually very willing. Okay, when they heard that they are going to, there will be possible third shots or even booster shots not to be given primarily for senior citizens, no, and those with comorbids, they were already asking, okay lang ba yan? I'm willing. Parang ganon. So it actually opened their eyes kasi now that they have received the vaccination, they knew that their apprehensions, the previous apprehensions were actually not founded. So now they are very much willing to have themselves vaccinated. I think if it is a means to really just incentivize people to have themselves vaccinated, that's all right. But to really withhold it probably will not be seen as something good, because you are basically withholding the right that is due to this specific subset of our population.
Yeah. So how can holding it or suspending it be more of an incentive as compared to really withholding it from them? Is there a way to sort of balance it off?
Baka medyo ano, no, ako ang iniisip ko nga maybe add a little more, no, for those who are going to have themselves vaccinated, like let us say for this particular once you get yourselves vaccinated, ganito na ang ating incentive sa'yo, maybe an additional, you know, additional money that they can receive, or maybe in terms of goodies na meron pa silang matatanggap on top of the money, no? So I think this is going to help a lot, no? We know that many of our countrymen who really needs this kind of benefits are those belonging to the lower economic strata, and we have to realize that it is actually this subset of our population that were really gravely affected by the pandemic, and therefore this kind of an incentive will really be a positive incentive. You know, it's something positive that will be viewed by them, and that will also, you know, be a good program, no, a campaign for the LGUs.
Mm-mm. Kasi nga, for most of them, Doktora, alam naman natin that this has become their lifeline.
Right, right.
Many of them belong to the informal sector. And this has become, as we said, their lifeline throughout this pandemic. Tapos kapag tatanggalin mo pa yun sa kanila, at...
nawala yung lifeline.
Diba? Nawala.
Mm-mm. Yes, right. In fact, Carmina, no, even the middle income group, no, this is something that is being looked forward by the middle income group. Kasi syempre we have to realize wala na silang trabaho, retired na yung mga karamihan na yan. And therefore, this is really an additional benefit na nakakadagdag, no, doon sa kanilang mga pangangailangan, no. Tugon sa kanilang mga pangangailangan. So I think we need to always keep in mind, no, kung ano yung mga pangangailangan ng mga tao, kasi para sa ganun, everybody will actually be happy, no?
Mm-mm. Kasi parang ang tingin din ng iba, parang pinaparusahan yung mga indigents kapag tanggalin pa ito.
Yes, right. Oo. It's not really a parusa in the sense na kasi it's really parang pushing the vaccination program also for their protection, no? But I think ang pinaka ano lang dito, ang negative side lang nito, yung hindi nila matatanggap yung dapat na matanggap nila. And therefore, baka instead of creating something good, pinalalala lang natin yung situation, no? Kasi bukod doon sa baka mas lalong magmatigas. Alam mo naman yung ibang tao, Carmina, no? Sa sometimes pag mas lalo mong mas lalo kang nagiging mahigpit sa kanila, mas lalong nagiging negative ang tingin nila. So we might as well, you know, create a program that will really entice people and then make them participate in the program instead of rejecting the program.
I mean, we're almost 2 years into this pandemic, right? We've just recently been awash with vaccines, no? Compared to other countries. Ngayon pa lang natin nararanasan yung oversupply nitong vaccines. But still, there is a huge part of our population that's quite hesitant still, right, to get vaccinated. Sa pag-aaral niyo po, Dr. Limpin, based on your assessment, what is the root cause of their hesitancy that up to now, almost 2 years in, there's still a lot of people who have been quite hesitant to get vaccinated? And how do you pierce through that bubble?
Well, ang napansin namin, no, number one factor dyan ay yung mga misinformation campaign, no, of the group who are anti-vaccination. And they have, you know, this group, they have actually really used the media and particularly social media, no, to the max na the false information that has been spread around really went like wildfire. And unfortunately, ito yung parang syempre, no, something sensational, and therefore it attracts the attention of many people, not realizing na these informations are not based from scientific evidences, no? So malaking problema, and that is why one very good way of countering this disinformation is really to have a very good communication strategy, no, para sa ganon maabot natin ang lahat ng kababayan natin, particularly yung mga senior citizens, yung mga nasa probinsya, yung mga nasa rural areas. Kasi unfortunately, yung mga nasa probinsya saka yung mga nasa rural areas and the seniors, they are the ones who became very vulnerable to all these misinformations, no? Kaya kailangan targetin natin sila. The ones here in Metro Manila, mas medyo ano pa tayo na at least na aabot pa natin yung mga tao, no? But itong mga sinabi ko, these are the ones who were actually made vulnerable by all these misinformations na ito.
But you know, doctor, that those who are vulnerable to that kind of misinformation and disinformation, that is not exclusive to one class, ha?
Right.
It cuts across social classes. Na ang mahirap pa dyan, yung mga mas nakakaangat, they have a certain circle of people that they have influence over. So mas napapalawig pa yung ganong klaseng pag-iisip.
Yeah, but that is correct, no, Carmina? But if you notice, mas marami ang bakunado nas in the upper economic strata. So it's not really a big problem for the A and B, no, but more of a problem to the C, D, and E. Kasi ito yung mga populations that are not being, that are actually being left, no, as far as the vaccination program is concerned. And then also doon sa across the country, yung mga nasa probinsya, nasa rural areas, ito yung mga this is where our bigger problem lies, no? Mm-hmm. And that is why lahat halos ng mga vaccines na meron doon sa mga probinsya, sila yung medyo nahihirapan, ano, na magamit yung mga bakuna na naroroon sa kanila. So sometimes if you notice, I don't know if you've heard of it, but there are already some people, even here in Metro Manila, no, there are some people who have already been receiving third dose or booster doses, no, ahead of the scheduled program of the Department of Health. Kaya nga minsan ako nagugulat ako, meron na ho kayong, kasi nagsasabi yung mga tao sa amin. No, sinasabihan ako, doktora, meron na ho akong third dose, meron na ho akong booster shots. Daig niyo pa kami. alam mo, tapos sabi ko, alam mo ninyo, wala pa ho kasi sa programa yan eh. And then, you know, some people are also being asked to pay for these third doses and for these booster shots, no? And I was actually telling my patients, according to the program of the government, you're not supposed to pay. And in fact, paano ho kayo makakakuha ng mga booster shots na yan o yung mga third doses na yan kung kasi ho ang lahat ng ito ay dapat kontrolado ng gobyerno, no? Yeah. So tapos para bayaran ninyo yan. I think sabi ko nga hindi na tama yung magbayad pa sila para dito.
We're going to talk more about the booster shots and possible third shots in a bit, Dr. Lim Pin. But I do want to go first into the possible ramifications of vaccine inequity. Kasi yung iba pong mga concerns, yung iba pong mga eksperto, really voicing out their concerns already because it's really going to widen the gap, the disconnect that's already being felt even during pre-pandemic, no, between the rich and the poor and the productivity later on. What concerns you the most regarding vaccine inequity, not just across areas, but across social classes as well?
Well, of course, no. What worries me the most is that it is the ones, yung the poor and also the ones who are in the rural areas in the provinces. They are the ones who are being left behind, no, in this vaccination campaign. And my worry is, of course, if they get infected, it is actually going to be a big problem because they are the people who will not be able to really afford the cost of healthcare. So that's my main problem with this inequity that we are seeing. So I hope that we'll be able to really have a solution to this. And I'm thinking that the primary solution will really be the how to counter the disinformation and misinformation. I think that is one thing that we need to do. And that is why I am actually now, we in the Philippine College of Physicians are now reaching out to some of our friends, no, particularly those who knows about communication, no, how to do effective communication. We want to get them, work with us, collaborate with us, so that we can create a campaign that will be more effective to get people to get to have themselves vaccinated. No?
Imagine Dr. Limpin, will almost nearing the 2-year mark, and yet here we are still talking about how to get effective communication out there. I mean, that says a lot.
Yeah. I think may problem talaga tayo, Carmina. And then, of course, the other problem is the problem that was created by the Dengbaksha, no? The Dengbaksha experience, no? So, yung mga provinces then where they had the Dengbaksha campaign and where the children were vaccinated, dito din namin nakikita yung mas maraming hindi nagpapabakuna. And that's why...
So, halimbawa, when we talk about effective communication, and we talk about, kasi hindi ano yan eh, hindi isang paraan lang sa lahat ng sektor, hindi ba? You have to be able to communicate to them in different ways.
Yes, because right.
They have certain belief systems that are distinct and separate from each other. So, halimbawa po, paano nyo i-communicate ito dun sa CD&E? Na sector halimbawa, paano nyo ito mako-communicate sa mga informal sectors, paano nyo ito mako-communicate dun sa beneficiaries ng 4Ps, paano kaya ito, Doctor?
I think dito kailangan muna, no, kausapin muna natin yung mga experts in communication, no, kasi really kami mga doktor, we think na alam naman namin kung paano, kung ano no ang talagang kailangan na information na makarating, but how to effectively communicate it, yun yung hindi namin forte yan, and that's why we need to really collaborate with the communication experts. And then I think the communication experts will also be able to tell us ano yung mga media that will the different media platforms that we can make use of para marating natin yung mga kailangang marating natin, no?
Because when you Dr. Limpin, because when you dig deep into it, you're going to see that they have certain belief systems, and these belief systems made them vulnerable to disinformation and misinformation. So kailangan yun muna yung mabuwag, diba, para makapasok po kayo.
Yeah, oo. Kaya nga mahirapan talaga kami. So kaya importante yung collaboration, no. But I think kakayanin naman natin. But I don't know if we'll really be able to really change the mindset of some people na talagang culturally yan na yung kanilang paniniwala. So that is something na hindi siguro natin mababago. But similar in the US, no. You have seen now that the US really having difficulty in getting a small percentage of the population get vaccinated, kasi talagang may mindset na talaga sila that they do not like to any form of vaccine. So ganun din si palagay ko dito sa Pilipinas, but as long as we'll be able to get around 80% or even up to 90% of the population, I think that will be a very good vaccination campaign already, or a vaccination program, kasi at least more than the herd immunity that we are targeting.
Yeah. Dr. Limpin, I want to touch on the booster shots now, third shots and all that. As you said, you have patients who already have gotten theirs. And who ba ito? It's just that, is it a third shot? Is it a full round of two doses?
Ah, kasi yung iba sinasabi nila booster shots eh, no? So I think tapos schedule sila for the fourth. So that means it's more of a booster shot. So parang booster shots. Yung iba naman parang third dose. No, so iba-iba, Carmina. So I think kailangan talaga nating I don't know, I think for a lot of people who are getting this, it is because of their fear that they might get COVID again. Mm-hmm. No, so ayaw nilang mangyari ito, and these are the people who have actually gotten COVID already, many of them. No, so kasi they know what is the experience like, no, getting COVID, so they do not want to go through it again.
Pero hindi ho ba dapat yung frontliners muna ang mauna?
Oo, kasi sabi ko nga sa kanila, naunahan niyo pa ho kami mga frontliners. Mm-hmm. Eh kami ho yung palaging nakaharap sa mga COVID-19 cases eh. Tama.
No, and because of that, aren't you going to appeal to, is it part of an appeal for the, to the government to get the guidelines out? To have yourselves get those booster shots before anyone else.
Yes, syempre, no, nag-aapila naman kami sa ating gobyerno, but we also trust our colleagues who are out there who comprises the experts, the vaccine experts panel ng Department of Health. So we need to trust our colleagues that they will be recommending what is right, no, for us. So it's really just a matter of trust among us.
And I hope that it's just a matter of time as well. Dr.
Yes, right. Oo. Ako nga, ninenervyos eh, no? Although, of course, not as nervous probably of some of my colleagues because I already had COVID. So my feeling is since I got COVID and then I received also the vaccination. So my immune system is better, you know, better prepared than any of the others who have not had COVID yet.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I'm super glad that I still get to talk to you, despite being having had COVID and going through all that nasty stuff. We appreciate you joining us on the show. Always, Dr. Maricar Limpin there, President of the Philippine College of Physicians. And once again, thanks for all that you do. Take care and keep safe.
Yeah, and stay safe, everyone.
Thank you. Appreciate it. We're going to take a break now. Up ahead, Sinovac claims its COVID-19 vaccine is safe, even for babies. Details of that and more when Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us here on AMC.
Smart Dishwashing Paste. May double tanggaling formula. Solid magtanggal ng heavy-duty sebo sa kawalit kaldero. Solid din magtanggal ng bakterya. Kaya number one na ang Smart Dishwashing Paste.
Bawat bahay linis, solid. Smart Dishwashing.
Smart Dishwashing Paste.
Mobility will be key. to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Back. You're still Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Global COVID-19 cases now approaching the 250 million mark. But over the last 3 months, the daily average has fallen by 36% as the surge from the Delta variant eases. Health experts are optimistic many nations have put the worst of the pandemic behind them thanks to vaccines and to better treatments. But they caution the colder weather and upcoming holiday gatherings may lead to another uptick. Infections are still rising in 55 out of 240 countries, with Russia, Ukraine, and Greece posting record levels or near record levels of new cases. Here in the Philippines, the number of active cases has fallen to its lowest level since March 1st. The number of active infections now at 33,000. After the health department recorded 2,605 new cases on Sunday. 191 additional deaths and nearly 4,000 more recoveries were also reported. Meanwhile, the country's COVID-19 positivity rate declines to 5.2%, the lowest since February 15th. The World Health Organization considers a positivity rate of 5% or less a good benchmark, as it indicates that the spread of the disease is under control. Officials are ramping up the COVID-19 vaccinations of minors now that they're allowed out in areas under alert level 2. In the city of Manila, more than 75,000 children have already registered for their shots. The local government has so far vaccinated 22,000 kids. Over in Tacloban, 300 miners were vaccinated last Thursday, while the town of Tansa in Cavite hopes to receive more vaccine supplies so they can continue with pediatric vaccinations. Overall, 29 million Filipinos have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19. Chinese drug maker Sinovac says its COVID-19 vaccine is safe for children and babies as young as 6 months old. The company's latest study covers 14,000 children ages 6 months to 17 years old. The results show that more than 18% had adverse vaccine-related reactions, mostly headaches and pain at the injection site. Sinovac also says a report on its vaccine's effectiveness could be released next year as it needs more time to analyze the data. Tacloban City marks the 8th year since Super Typhoon Yolanda devastated Western Visayas and left thousands dead and millions homeless. A mass was held on Sunday on the eve of the anniversary. Another mass this morning at the Holy Cross Memorial, while a candle lighting ceremony will be held at the Leyte Provincial Gym later tonight. Tacloban Mayor Alfred Romualdez says the province has moved on from Yolanda, but they will never forget those who perished and the lessons they learned from the tragedy. Yolanda, with international name Haiyan, is one of the most powerful tropical cyclones ever recorded. It left some 6,300 people dead, 28,000 injured, and displaced millions of people. News overseas now, U.S. President Joe Biden is set to sign his $1 trillion infrastructure bill into law. The measure passed through Congress Friday, ending a long standoff within the Democratic Party. It's touted as a once-in-a-generation investment that will create millions of jobs as the Biden administration undertakes the biggest ever upgrade of America's transportation infrastructure. Biden says he will sign the bill soon in a formal ceremony that highlights all the people who worked on it, Democrats and Republicans alike.
And for all of you at home who feel left behind and forgotten, in an economy that's changing so rapidly, this bill is for you. The vast majority of the thousands of jobs that will be created don't require a college degree. There'll be jobs in every part of the country, red states, blue states, cities, small towns, rural communities, tribal communities. This is a blue-collar blueprint to rebuild America, and it's long overdue. See the effects of the bill, this bill, probably starting within the next 2 to 3 months.
Good news for Philippine motorists. Oil prices are set for a rollback this week. Gasoline prices may see the biggest cut of up to 1 peso and 20 centavos per liter. Diesel prices may go down by 70 centavos per liter, while kerosene prices may be slashed by up to 75 centavos per liter. Global crude prices sank last week as Saudi Arabia's oil output is set to surpass 10 million barrels per day for the first time since the onset of this pandemic. This week's rollback will break 10 straight weeks of oil price hikes here at home. One of the biggest residents of Sesame Street gets vaccinated for COVID-19. On Twitter, Big Word said that while his wing felt a little sore after getting the shot, he's happy it will be able to protect him and other people from the virus. He adds he apparently had been getting other sorts of vaccines since he was a little bird. Big Bird's COVID vaccine shot comes as the U.S. begins administering jabs to children aged 5 to 11. Good job, Big Bird. Another star-studded superhero film about a race of immortals and a new drama about Princess Diana are some of the new movie releases this month. Manny the Movie Guy lets us know what he thinks about Eternals and Spencer.
Marvel enlists the help of Nomadland Oscar winner Chloe Zhao to write and direct Eternals. It might have sounded good on paper, but the final product is a big letdown.
We came here 7,000 years ago.
Except after the events of Avengers Endgame, we get to see the saga of the Eternals, a race of immortal beings protecting Earth. They're abandoned angels, if you may.
Can you guys help fight Thanos?
While I admire the diversity of the characters, Brian Tyree Henry plays the gay Fastos, or the first deaf superhero with Lauren Ridloff's Makari, they feel like gimmicks when there's no strong foundation to back them up. The big name stars of the cast, like Salma Hayek and Angelina Jolie, are just there to attract viewers. But even the most ardent Marvel fans will be bored with its unnecessary long running time. 156 minutes of clueless characters flying and running around.
This is what the end of the world looks like.
But at least this is visually pleasing, although it has the Marvel formula down pat. Bloated action scenes? Check. Corny one-liners? Check. It even has mid and post-credit scenes to introduce characters you really won't care about. Eternals is supposed to redefine the Marvel Universe, but it's more like sticking to the tried and true. And for that, Eternals gets 2.5 out of 4, only in theaters, kisses. Also out in theaters, Spencer.
3 days.
Kristen Stewart deserves an Oscar nomination for portraying the emotionally fragile Princess Diana. Her nuanced acting holds the film from start to finish.
Not you!
Billed as a fable from a true tragedy, Spencer shows a slice of life, but an important chapter at that, of Princess Diana. Set in December 1991 during the Christmas festivities at the Queen's Sandringham Estate, the film follows the Princess of Wales as she rebels against tradition while simultaneously doubting her marriage and forming stronger bonds with her sons.
What happened to make you so sad?
The Princess is very relatable here. It shows a Diana that is full of love, even though that love is long gone. Tragedy indeed. And for that, Spencer gets the perfect 4 out of 4, my pick of the week, kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
That'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us this Monday. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines Podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Play back this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on the News Channel.
There are candidates offering their own track records and platforms of government. We look more closely into what these candidates have to offer as solutions to some of the most pressing issues confronting Filipinos today. Illegal drugs is a very serious problem. Is Ping Lacson going to deal with this problem? Is there going to be a different kind of an approach on anti-drugs campaign in the country? Kung gagamitin ng isang kandidato ay hindi siya directly magbibigay ng pera at gagawa siya ng ayuda. Is that a veiled kind of vote buying? What is it that you're seeing now, if at all, the Marcoses and the Dutertes will be a strong force to contend with?
Dina Monzon Palma reports, only here on ANC.
At a time when we are gripped by fear, we are inspired by your courage. At a time when we are in dire need of hope, we look up to your sense of duty and compassion. At a time when the default reaction is self-preservation, you put the needs of the sick above your own. All those who are in the front lines of this pandemic. Thank you. This is the Philippines. We are ANC.
Good afternoon. Here are the biggest stories at this hour. I'm Carmina Constantino. Manila City lifts its mandatory face shield policy, except in hospitals or medical settings. The Philippine capital is the first city to lift the face shield mandate in Metro Manila after Mayor Francisco Isko Moreno Domagoso signed an executive order to formalize the new policy. Metro Manila Development Authority Chairman Benhur Abalos says the region's mayors have also agreed to do away with the face shield mandate. The head of the country's interagency task force says most of their members are now leaning the same way. Families head out with their children on the first weekend of the Alert Level 2 in Metro Manila. Children were finally allowed to visit malls, parks, churches, and other public areas for the first time since the onset of this pandemic. Now, this is a big relief for the tourism and trade departments as they've been pushing for the lifting of the age requirement for tourist areas and establishments. And Australia will begin administering booster shots as it emerges from a surge of infections driven by the Delta variant. The additional shots will be given to people 18 and over 6 months after their second shot. Some members of the vulnerable population have already been given their third shots ahead of the wider rollout. That's the latest at this hour. I'm Carmina Constantino. More news comes your way on The Rundown at 2. Keep it here on ANC. Keep safe.